Moika.
Hey.
Welcome to our podcast, Mastering Finland.
I'm Jean and I'm from California.
I'm Petra and I'm from the Czech Republic.
We're here to chat about our life in Finland. Hi everyone. So today we have two guests with us. We have Shanara and Maria. I know them from the kindergarten that I work at in Helsinki. And they also have very interesting stories as to how they got to Finland and different ones from the guests we've had so far. So I hope you enjoy this episode. So let's get started. Shanara, why don't you tell us where you're from?
I'm from Australia originally. I lived near Brisbane in Queensland.
And when did you come to Finland?
I moved here in 2016.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, so it's been 4 years.
Yeah, almost, yeah.
So, Maria, where are you from?
I'm originally from the Philippines, but I left when I was 10 years old.
Oh, that's right. You have a very interesting background because you moved around with your parents, right?
Yeah. I first moved to the Falkland Islands, mm-hmm. and then I had my high school in the Falklands, and then St. Helena Island. And they're both part of the British territory.
Yeah.
And then I moved to England to study, and then Libya. So Libya was the last place before coming here.
To Finland. Okay. And you came to Finland what year?
2013.
Yes. Okay. So you've been here 7 years now.
Yeah, coming up to 7 years. Yeah. Wow. In the spring.
Okay.
Yeah.
So how did you guys end up in Finland? Shanara, we'll start with you.
So I met my Finnish partner in Australia. So we met, he moved over there in 2012, I think, or 2011 to study there his bachelor's degree. So we met at university in Australia.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and then you came to Finland eventually.
Yeah, and then
eventually.
We came to Finland.
Yeah. And Maria, how did you end up in Finland?
I actually met my husband now. I met him on holiday in the Philippines. We were mm-hmm. both on holiday there around the same time, and he was traveling with his Finnish friend.
Okay.
And yeah, I met him on holiday.
Okay.
So it was a holiday romance.
Oh. Yeah, that went on forever.
Yes. It's still a holiday romance going on.
How sweet. And did you guys know or hear anything about Finland before coming, moving to the country?
I don't think I even knew where it was.
I wasn't familiar about Finland.
Yeah.
I knew Sweden and Russia.
Yeah, same.
But Estonia, actually, I also knew of Estonia.
Yeah.
Yeah. But not Finland.
Finland.
That's so sad that
Finland
is like overlooked always.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. What was your first impression then when you first came here? Do you remember?
I thought
when
it was very bare. With,
okay, the land.
No, the people. I just thought for a city, I thought that, it's so little people.
Oh, okay, yeah.
That is Helsinki.
Yeah, Helsinki, because we were in Helsinki. And I thought, this can't be a city. There's not many people. Mm-hmm. I mean, which now I really appreciate it. I love that it's not so busy compared to other cities. Mm-hmm. But I thought it was a little bit... Yeah, it wasn't so busy. Not what I expected, anyway.
If you talk to a Finn from the country, though, they think it's New York City or something.
Yeah, that's true.
It's bustling. But I feel like after living in Jyväskylä for a while, coming to Helsinki does seem a lot, bustly and busy.
Yeah, I've heard, It's not busy. It doesn't have a lot of... noise pollution,
that's true. Yeah,
you know,
I guess
I mean?
It's not like bustling, but it just seems like there's more going on,
there's
more cars, more people.
Yes.
Yeah, so Shanara, what was your first impression when you came to Finland?
Well, I visited Finland twice before I actually moved here, so I visited the first time in the summer and then the second time in the winter.
Okay.
So I thought that it was like Finland had like a really relaxing vibe and like very. Very calm. I don't know. It's really different to Australia, I think.
Yeah.
Which is surprised. Like, people are always surprised when I say that I find Finland to be much calmer and much more easygoing compared to Australia, because that's the vibe that Australia has. But I just think it's I don't know, it's just calm.
Yeah.
It's easy to just be here.
Exactly. And I feel like it has to do with that there aren't that many people here. So it's just a completely different environment. Did you guys experience any culture shock when you first came? Anything that stands out in your memory, maybe?
I guess when meeting my... At the time, he was my boyfriend. So when I met his friends, and I usually, like, before, when I would meet people, even for the first time, I would kiss them on the cheek and then give them a hug.
Yeah.
And I found that very awkward.
Because, to do that.
Yeah, because they were so awkward.
Mm.
But at first I was like, oh, that's weird. You could just feel that it wasn't comfortable for them.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
And I remember one of, like, his best friends, it took him 2 years to feel that kind of love hug, you know?
Love hug,
and
yeah.
That it was meaningful.
Right,
and I remember telling Jeffrey that, oh, he actually hugged me with feelings, you know, because I was, and it was on my birthday, and it was because he had a few drinks, and he he kind of picked me up and he said, happy birthday, Maria, and I was like, oh, it was so meaningful. It was one of the best, I always remember that. It was one of the best hugs because I knew he wasn't like that.
Right, but does he remember?
No, I don't think he does.
Okay.
He probably thought that, no,
it
I didn't
normal.
Do that. He was like, no. I don't remember hugging you with feelings.
And Shannara, what does anything stand out to you in terms of culture shock when you first came here?
I can't think of anything. I mean, mostly the weather, I guess, is the big difference.
Yeah,
so, like, the winter for me was, like, the first winter was hard.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
same.
The darkness and the... Because it's so much colder, you know, it doesn't get that cold where I'm from.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, winter in where I'm from is, like, 20 degrees, so...
Okay, that's, like, the summers here.
Yeah, so, I think that was, like, the hardest was getting through the first winter.
Yeah, I remember also my first winter, it was... It was pretty depressing, and I thought that I, like, was prepared because I knew about it and how the darkness, especially the darkness, is what got to me. So people would tell me, like, take vitamin D. I don't know if you did that, Shannara.
I think I still do it.
Yeah. But does that help? Because I don't think it really helped me.
To be honest, the winter hasn't really affected me.
Oh, okay.
I first came here on holiday in the autumn.
Okay.
And I stayed for 3 months. I was here on holiday.
Okay.
And I didn't, I guess also because I was so excited, I wasn't yet living here. It was more that I was on holiday. I was, you know, getting to know my partner. So it was a bit different. You know, it didn't really bother me because I knew I was going to go away again. And
Yeah.
So even now, it doesn't really bother me.
Oh, wow.
So I just try to think to myself,
good.
Well, I'm going to go on holiday. If it bothers me that much,
that's true.
Then
that's what
away.
You have to do. Yeah.
So you kind of also have to make an effort.
That's true.
To
avoid depression.
Of course, there are some people who really are depressed about it.
Right.
You know, they can't, it's not like they can snap out of it.
Right.
But you also have to give yourself a fighting chance to actually make an effort.
Right.
To do something,
yeah,
you know, mingle
yeah.
still with friends during winter, even if it is really hard, because everyone wants to hibernate.
Exactly.
I kind of see it, too, as just a time to relax.
Yeah.
And I don't take, like, the first one was hard, but now I'm like, I see it as a time to stay home and be indoors, I'm not too concerned about, I try not to be too concerned about whether I can go outside, although, you know, it does start to get a bit depressing, especially this winter, but...
Yeah.
Yeah, I try to just see it that this is the time that I spend indoors and doing indoor things, and then when summer comes around, then
you go out.
Then I go out.
Yeah.
But I know lots of my Finnish friends, they really hate it.
Yeah.
They really hate it. So a lot of them go away during the autumn and winter time.
I've noticed that
they can't stand it.
Yeah, yeah.
But it
could get brutal, but I guess just depends on your mindset. I feel like everyone deals with it differently or, like, comes to terms with it differently. Yeah. What have you learned to appreciate about the Finnish culture? Now that, especially since you guys have been here for quite some time, I feel like you guys are our first guests who have been here, like, past
the 2 years.
I've just learned to appreciate the things that I wasn't comfortable with before, or things that I found odd. Now I don't really find it that odd. I mean, we laugh about it and joke about it, but it's
normal now.
Yeah, it's normal. And most of the time, you kind of, because you adapt to it, you start to become like that.
Yeah. Oh,
and I notice that more when I go on holiday.
Like, for instance, is there something...
For example, like, if I'm on holiday, I don't really want to mingle so much with other people. As before, I want to meet other people. Like, I was really keen.
Like, new friends. And,
yeah, I was, like, really keen. And now I kind of love my personal space. Yeah. And that kind of thing. So, and now I get really awkward in, like, elevators. And I never used to. Before, I'd be there smiling. Yeah. And now I look down.
Yeah.
And just little things that you would... You know, I used to find really strange, but now I've...
It's just normal
now. It's just part of me now.
Yeah, it's a part of you.
It's part of me.
It's part of your new identity.
But I think you're half Finn now.
But I think that's how you actually, when you move somewhere, you feel happier because you kind of adapt, but without forcing anything. It just kind of happens because when you try to fight things or you're annoyed about every little thing, that what they do or what doesn't work, of course you become unhappy.
Right, exactly.
But if you just don't, just let it be, you know?
I feel like
just accept it.
Exactly. At a certain point, you just have to surrender.
And especially if you're really gonna stay here.
Exactly.
There's no point in hating everything, hating the weather,
right?
You know, the culture, because people are not so, you know, open, let's say, when you first meet them.
Yeah.
You just have to be, you just have to relax and go with the flow.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, that's what they do. They just relax and go with the flow. They don't put pressure on anything.
That's true, though.
I like about Finland. Yeah. That's what I appreciate about Finland, is that it's so much easier just to be you here.
Yeah.
I don't know, there's less pressure.
That's something I said in the previous episode, was like, I don't know what it is about Finland, but I feel comfortable here just to be me. So it's interesting that you guys also feel that level of
social climbing kind of, do you know what I mean? Like, in some countries or cultures, there's that, you know, let's say you have a good job, you have to be like...
Right, like social status.
Yeah, I'm sure they do have it, but it's nowhere near as competitive as other countries.
That's
for
true.
Sure.
Yeah, it's really very not competitive at all.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did you guys find anything difficult when you transitioned into your life in Finland?
I think for me, the language was just the hardest, because I haven't lived, like, you've lived in Helsinki the whole time.
Yeah.
Whereas I lived first in Kouvola, and then I lived in Jyväskylä, and then I finally came to Helsinki. So the language was a big issue.
Okay,
you know, it's definitely, like, not true that everybody here speaks English.
Yeah.
So, and my boyfriend's family, they don't speak any English.
Oh,
so
that was
hard for me to
kind of
bond with people, because if I don't have a common language, it's very difficult. So.
Yeah.
That's true.
That's true. And on top of, I guess, coming here first and knowing, like, seeing that they are reserved, and then having that language barrier in addition, it probably makes it double. I guess this brings us to rewind to how you guys ended up here, because you guys came here on different grounds than, for instance, like, I and some of my friends did. We came here as students, but you guys came through your spouse or partner at the time. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So can you just describe how that process started? Like, how long did it take for all the paperwork to get done?
So I met Jeffrey in 2011.
Okay.
And so I had come here twice during that almost 2 years period.
Just as a tourist?
Just as a tourist for like 3 months at a time.
Okay.
And until we decided, because we wanted to get to know each other, because obviously we had met on holiday, and most of the getting to know each other was Skype or, you know, so that kind of stuff. So we really wanted to see if this was something that, you know, we wanted to do, me to move here or wherever it may be. So I came here officially in 2013 to live.
Okay.
But it was very, very quick. I remembered I was here on holiday during the Christmas time.
Yeah.
And before I left, we sorted out our my papers, basically.
Yeah.
And so because I went back to the Philippines because it was the easiest, and plus the embassy was really friendly. I think I've mentioned this morning that the Finnish embassy was one of the friendliest embassy had ever. Mm-hmm. Come across, honestly. Yeah. They're so friendly, and they don't give you a hard time, mm-hmm. and they're just very helpful.
Mm-hmm.
So when I left here and then I went back to the Philippines, the next day when I arrived, basically, I went to the the embassy, and then I handed the papers to apply for it.
Okay.
They already have a record of me applying for visa before, you know, because I came here as a tourist.
Oh, okay.
So they have already that record. Yes. And I applied, and then the next day I was getting on the plane to go to another island in the Philippines, to just go on holiday.
Mm-hmm.
I got an email to say that it was approved.
Oh, wow.
So it was very, very quick.
That was really, really fast.
But at that time, I think there wasn't... I mean, that there were foreigners here, of course, but it was just a lot easier.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't have to have I didn't have to show any income. And my partner didn't have to show any income.
Right.
So,
because now you have to show that you can financially support yourself for the time that you're moving.
Yeah.
But you didn't have to do any of that. You could just move.
And I remember I had the documents.
Yeah.
And she looked at it and she said, you don't need this because he's a Finnish citizen. So so I don't know if I did need it, if it wasn't.
What kind of documents do you need?
It was a bank statement
to show that
he has savings or how much does he earn, contract and things like that.
Yeah.
But I thought I had to show that because that's something that you would think that you
typically
would need, you know?
Yeah.
But I didn't need it at all. It was basically the form that I've had and just
your passport.
Copies. Yeah, and just copies of my visits here from basically my visa when I come here to visit him. How long we've been together. But that was it, and there was no interview. I didn't get any interview or anything like that.
It was so easy,
so
breezy.
It was really, really
back
easy.
Then.
Yeah.
Wow.
So yeah, and then I got it, but because we had already bought my ticket for a few months later.
Yeah.
So I just basically stayed until I needed to come here, and then
this is
2013.
Okay, and just to clarify, this is on a type.
Yeah, it was
A
like
or
a
B
type B
residence
it
permit.
It was a type B, and it was it was kind of translated special. So I guess it's when you're living with your
partner. Civil union.
Yeah, like that kind.
Yeah.
But that's what it was kind of translated. Well, I'm assuming my husband's really bad at translating anything for me, but he was saying that, it translates to something special, so I don't know if that's actually
you're special.
True. Yeah, you're special.
It's for special people.
It's for special people, Maria.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And so that is valid for how long? Then?
1 year.
1 year.
Yeah.
Okay.
Valid for 1 year. And I think that they give you that so you could see, do you want to, what mm-hmm. do you want to do after?
Yeah.
So it gives you a good amount of time.
Okay.
But at that point, when I had already come, basically officially moved here.
Yeah.
I had visited twice, and we had been together almost 2 years at that point.
Okay.
So when I applied, we had been together almost 2 years.
Okay, yeah.
So during that 2 years, we were just having the long distance relationship.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So, but the process of you getting that residence permit, it was
very,
very fast.
It was very quick, and I remember I was so surprised because I was about to get on the plane and I got an email.
Yeah.
And all it said was that your visa or your permit has been approved.
Yeah.
And that you can collect your permit, and then it had a date because it was going to come from Finland, the card.
Oh, right. Yes.
So
have
I
to
had
ship
to wait
to
for
you.
That anyway. Yeah. But it didn't take long. But anyway, as I said, we had already booked my ticket to come back here for a couple months later.
After,
So I just had to wait. I think it was 2 months. I can't remember how long.
Okay. I feel like now I imagine it'd probably be a lot slower, the process, just knowing
really
how many
is.
People actually try to get into Finland.
Yeah.
So then did you have to change that residence permit into something else, I guess, a different type after that 1 year expired?
Married.
Okay, yes,
yeah,
you got
so
married.
We got married. But that didn't take long. I just had to transition to apply for a different visa, which was a permit.
Okay, so different residence permit, yeah, type A.
And it was okay. The 4 years that it's valid for. Yeah. And that took... So we got married in October. Mm-hmm. I can't remember the date. And then in December, I got the permit.
Oh, wow. Okay, so it was also pretty quick.
Yeah, it was really quick. And I was here. I didn't have to leave.
You didn't have to leave and then come back in with the new residence permit.
There was just a form that you had to fill up, you know, when you get married, and then you just had to show the population, you know, that you get from Maestrati.
Oh, yeah, that you registered into the
records.
Because
it shows that you're married and things like that, so you just had to show that.
Okay.
But it was really simple. There was no fuss.
Yeah.
I thought it was really easy, honestly.
So then you have type A residence permit now. So you get all the benefits of... a Finnish citizen. Yeah. And are you thinking of getting Finnish citizenship, you think?
Well, I haven't prioritized my Finnish language, but I did do an 8 months course, but it's that... Even if you do a course, you really have to keep it up. You can't just do the course and then expect that, okay, I'm done, that's it.
So
no, you have to continue and practice. Yeah, and I just haven't prioritized.
Maintain it. So in order to get Finnish citizenship, you have to pass a language test, right?
Yes.
And Shannara has a lot of experience with the Finnish language courses.
She's really good.
Yeah. So Shannara, you came here and you actually did the integration program.
Yeah. Yeah. So when you come here, you get this 3-year integration program. So I was on that program for 2 years.
Okay.
When I first arrived.
And basically that's learning the Finnish language.
Yeah.
Mainly.
Yeah. Mainly learning Finnish language, and it's supposed to also be about preparing you to work here. Yeah. So, you know, they help you with your CV or...
Okay.
But...
Just to adapt into the
basic
work. Yeah, yeah. It's nothing new, really.
No,
or
no, not from where I come from. I mean, I would say it's pretty similar to Australia.
Okay,
so,
yeah.
But I imagine from coming from other countries, it might
could
be very,
be
very
different.
So,
yeah. So you actually, Shannara actually did take 2 years of Finnish language courses full time. And by full time, we mean Monday
to Friday, five hours a day at least, usually 4 or 5 hours a day at least, yeah.
And it was covering speaking, grammar, writing,
everything. Yeah, yeah.
And you have to take it for 3 years?
Well, the integration program goes for 3 years.
Okay.
Up to 3 years. You can get an extension in special circumstances, but...
Yeah.
I mean, usually that special circumstance is if you come here not knowing how to read and write.
Oh, okay. If you need more time.
Extra time.
Yeah. Yeah. And so the integration program starts immediately after you arrive into Finland.
From my memory, it was as soon as you register with TE office, then your time starts.
Okay. The TE office is the unemployment,
office.
Yeah. They help you out.
Yeah. And so if you don't take advantage of the 3-year integration program in that time slot, as soon as you arrive, then you miss out and you can't.
You miss out and then
Maria knows that.
Actually, because obviously, because Jeffrey didn't know much about this. You know, he's been here since he was 12.
Right.
He didn't know. He just went straight to school.
Yeah.
So my thing was that I can't wait to go to work. So I as soon as I arrived, I got a job on the same month I applied.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So
and I remember when I went to the tax office and she was asking me some questions.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, I got a job already. And she was like, already? But I see that you're only arrived this month. And I was like saying to her, well, if you really want a job, you'll get one. You know, I was like so keen. But so I didn't know about this, that, you know, I could go to a course and things like
that. So no one had informed you at any point?
No, I didn't. I had no clue. Mm. I had no clue about it.
Yeah.
And then it was later on, I think 4 years later or something like that, I decided that I wanted to study Finnish.
Yeah.
That it was about time. And I was also starting to get interested.
Mm-hmm.
So I go to the TE office and I'm like, yeah, I want to study Finnish. And I thought, okay. And she's like, yeah, you don't qualify for this anymore.
Yeah,
I
mean, missed the window.
Yeah, you missed your window.
A long time ago.
Too late. And I was like, oh, okay, well, then I'll just pay. So I did a course for 8 months, but it was so little. I think for the whole year, it was, I don't know, 100 and something euros.
For 8 months?
Yeah, for 8 months. Okay. And it was 4 days a week.
Okay.
Yeah, 4 days a week for... 4 hours maybe, four hours, something like that.
Yeah,
so I took that time to, because I was like, okay, I'm really
super
interested.
Determined.
Yeah, and so I was like, I'm gonna do it. So I did that for 8 months.
Yeah.
So I really missed my chance, but I really wasn't informed and I really didn't know. So that's why when I hear other foreigners saying that, yes, I did this course, and like when I went to the Finnish class, most of them had just arrived. And they were like, yeah, I went to the TE office. Yeah. And I was like, I never did this.
Yeah.
But I think, to be honest, like, I wouldn't have known either.
I was about to say.
Because that a couple of months before I arrived in Finland, because my boyfriend, he had a friend who had brought her boyfriend over as well.
Yeah.
And so I had told him to get in contact with them and ask if there was any extra things that we needed to know about before we would come to Finland, like, because I was getting my paperwork and everything ready. And that was when we found out at that point that I was eligible for this, that I could go to the unemployment office and that I was eligible for Keller. And otherwise I wouldn't have known about it either.
Yeah.
I had no idea because it wasn't, I don't think it was written anywhere on Mikkeli at least.
Yeah, I had no clue. And obviously my husband had no clue about it.
Because he never had to go through that.
No, so I was like, okay. But anyway, I also, because you don't have to do it. So also I got a job and they probably thought TU office was like, okay, she got a job, great. Right?
Yeah, so no one stopped you at any point. Yeah,
maybe if you hadn't gotten a job so quickly and you had to go to TE office.
Right. Exactly.
Maybe then you would have found out about it.
I think so, because it was on the same month that I got a job. So and honestly, I was so keen. I was like, I hadn't worked for a bit because I was traveling back and forth here.
Yeah.
So I just couldn't wait to work.
Yeah.
You know, and kind of have a normal routine again. And
get your life settled and started.
So I was just really excited about that.
Yeah.
But I mean, you know, it happened and at least I did the course in the end after 4 years. So it's all good.
Better late than never.
Yeah. It worked out fine.
But so now you, Maria, just have to pass the language test and then you can be eligible for the citizenship.
Yeah. Because once you pass it, you can just get the passport and then. Yes.
And then
you're done.
Yeah, and then you're done.
You're done.
Stuck with you.
Yeah, you're stuck with me.
Whether you like it or not. And Shanara, you were talking about how you knew about the Kela because of your friends.
Mm.
And Kela is the social services here in Finland. Yeah. So they deal with all the social benefits and the welfare system. So what did you qualify for in terms of social benefits?
So because when I came here, I got a type A permit straight away. I got a 1 year type A permit.
And that is because
of the family. So I applied for the family ties. So I think the same thing as Maria, but I guess because we'd lived together for the 2 years when we applied, maybe that's why I got type A and she got type B.
Yeah. Oh, this is, I think what I had was not a family tie.
Yeah.
Yeah, mine was, that's why it was like special.
Yeah.
Case. It wasn't a family tie.
Okay.
It was like...
It was almost like a trial period, you think, or something for people
that.
In relationships.
Exactly, it was that.
Okay.
And
you were the 90-day fiancé.
Yeah, basically, I was that. But as my husband said, are you still scamming me? My husband says, are you still scamming me? Because this is a really long scam.
It's very elaborate.
Because we've been together for 9 years, almost 9 years, and he's like, are you still scamming me? And I'm like, yes, I'm still trying to scam you. Yes, that's what I'm trying to do.
That's hilarious. So then, you, Shanara, came on the type A residence permit already.
Yeah.
And that is because you applied for the family ties one. And they considered you, I guess, family because you were able to prove or show that you lived together for 2 years prior to the application.
Yeah, so we had to live together. Yeah, so part of the application was that we had to live together for 2 years, which we proved with rental agreements from Australia.
Oh, that's why you had that. That's what you were talking about earlier, right? And I was thinking, oh, I never had to prove that, but that's because you applied.
Yeah, because that was part of our... Of course, if we were married, we would have had to provide a marriage certificate, but we weren't married at the time, so...
Yeah.
So we just had this... that it was like cohabitation. Mm-hmm. It was like listed as in the forum. So we had that and we'd lived together for 2 years.
Yeah.
That we just made that cut off for the 2 years. And then, so then, but then I applied from within Finland. So I didn't apply through the embassy.
Oh, that's right. You didn't. Yeah. You came, yeah. you just came to Finland.
Yeah, I just came here because I guess, because I'm from Australia, so I don't need to apply for a tourist visa.
Oh, so right. I just so you can still get in the country.
On a tourist, like, right. On a Schengen type thing. Yeah. So I was able to just come, and I had all my paperwork and my appointment booked at the police station when you can still do it at the police station.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I remember
that.
You can't
do it at the police station anymore, so...
Yeah, it's separate now.
Yeah, so back then when I came, you could apply at the police station.
For the residence permit.
Yeah. So now it has to all go through Migri.
Migri. And it was pretty fast for you, right?
I got mine in 2 weeks. Which is, like, I've heard I must have been really lucky because I came in the middle of the refugee crisis as well.
So
I'm surprised that it didn't slow it down at all. But
you probably came right in the nick of time.
Yeah.
That's really
You made the cut.
Yeah, you did.
You got,
And then after 1 year, I had to reapply. And then they gave me a 4-year permit. So now I have the 4-year permit.
Is that just the process? They first try it. Is it also like a trial period?
I heard that it's just to make sure that. Yeah.
I think it's also like when I went back to reapply, I had to prove that we still lived together.
Okay.
Just that I hadn't just come to the country to get my visa.
Yeah.
And then we just split ways and went off. But so we had to prove that we still lived together and that we were still in a relationship for me to get the 4-year permit.
Yeah. And right now you have type A still residence permit.
Type A.
And does it expire? Do you have to keep renewing it?
It would expire in, well, I've had it now for 3 years, so I guess it expires in like 1 year.
Anyway, like what I'm applying now, so after the 4 years, you apply and you get the permanent.
Yeah.
Unless you choose to get the citizenship.
Oh, right. Okay, so the permanent residence permit is just right under the citizenship.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah. So the next step after the permit would be citizenship.
Yeah.
And you guys are both at that stage.
Well, Maria is.
I am. I'm waiting. Oh, you are. I'm still waiting.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Yes, it's taking a little bit longer than...
It takes longer these days because obviously there's a lot more people. So. Yeah.
And Shannara, you just need to... Once this one expires, you could apply for...
But I'm going to apply for citizenship this year, so...
Yeah, because you've done already the test.
Yeah, because I've already done the language test.
So and you passed and everything.
And so I'm just waiting for the time now.
Yeah.
So Maria has the time and I have the language.
Yeah, I know. Mixed together. It's just, I was like...
So for me, I have to be here for 4 years because of the family ties and I'm eligible to apply for
citizenship.
So
okay,
and that is coming up in April, so I can apply in April for citizenship. So
and I mean, you're technically going to get it because you passed the language test, and that's really the
it's already
requirement.
Like automatic, basically. Because once you have that, that's all you need.
Wow, that's exciting.
Yeah,
that's so like in 2 years you could be a Finnish citizen. Would it be dual? Or less.
Yeah, I'll be dual.
Okay, so you'll still keep your Australian in.
Yeah.
So, Shannara, in addition to working at the kindergarten, you are also taking classes. You're in a program, it's the Early Childhood and Care program. It's a bachelor's program.
Yeah, a bachelor's program in University of Tampere.
Yeah. How long ago did you start this program?
I started it in August last year, so just over 6 months ago.
And does this qualify you to teach in Finland then?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'll be a qualified teacher, kindergarten and preschool.
Okay, just kindergarten and preschool.
Yeah.
Okay. And what would you say is the general philosophy behind the Finnish pedagogy in this program? Like
each university in Finland apparently has kind of a different kind of way that they teach.
Mm-hmm.
So Tampere University is very focused on social sciences.
Okay.
So we kind of learn a lot about like social justice, like racism and sexism.
Uh-huh.
So we're learning a lot about how those topics are seen in the kindergarten.
Okay.
And being aware of these kinds of issues within the children as well. Like,
right.
Because, you know, even 4, 5, 6 year olds, they can still show racism towards another child.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
So we're learning a lot about actually like identifying these issues and also how to
that's so cool.
even teach about it.
And
you know, a lot of people say that children that age are, they're too young to learn about these topics, we're doing a lot of like kind of studying a lot about, you know, how children can be learning about these topics.
Yeah, I think that's so important now with so many, the international community is growing here, and I think it's just important that you address it as it's happening instead of waiting later, which is good.
The curriculum is quite vaguely written in a way in Finland.
We've spoken about this before,
it's very different. I think, like, I'm not familiar with the US system, for example, but what I've heard is, you know, there's a lot of requirements in the US that by this age they need to know X, Y, and Z. Yeah. By this age they need to know this.
They're like measurable outcomes.
So in Finland there's not, we don't have those kinds of things. Like, they're not having to learn to read and write by the time they're 5 years old.
It's not expected.
It's not expected. Right. If a child is interested, then it's supported.
Right.
But it's not expected that every child has to learn how to read and write by the time they go to first grade. That's something that they learn in school.
Right.
So I think that the curriculum in Finland is kind of vaguely written in that there's kind of like learning areas.
Yeah.
And then it's kind of up to the teachers to use their professional opinions and their expertise to teach or to teach how they see fit or how they think that their children will learn best. And
so they give a lot of freedom for teachers to kind of approach it as they
and
see.
And there's no inspections.
Because, like me and Shannara were just talking about how eventually by the age of 11, you were saying that everyone ends up at the same level. Like
Everybody catches up.
Everyone catches up, exactly. Yeah. So it just seems a little pointless, to like expedite it in the beginning.
Yeah. And it's very stressful, not just for us, but
for the children.
For the children,
it puts a lot of pressure on teachers.
Yeah.
You know, Finland is very like play-based pedagogy. That's the big thing in Finland is, you know, learning through play.
Yeah.
So it's not necessarily just letting the children to go and sit and play with some Legos.
Yeah.
Although, of course, that's something.
Right.
Like, that's not wrong, but it's also, you know, that, you know, the teachers are expected to get in and play as well. I mean, it's part of the curriculum. It's even written that the teachers should be getting in and playing with the children sometimes, not just always sitting back and watching.
So, and we teach them in those times by communicating with them and developing their language skills, just the very
social
social skills, just the very, I guess, basic things that every human needs to develop.
Who are not maybe as confident, and maybe they're playing in a group and they're a little bit more shy, and we've had kids like that.
Yeah.
And if you help them out a little bit, that's also part of it.
Yeah.
You know, that really helps them out.
Yeah. And also just, I'm just thinking in, you know, our kindergarten and what we do, because this is my first time in a Finnish kindergarten, and I've just noticed that it's really just daily activities that every human needs to partake in, like, you know, hygiene habits and just showing respect to peers, you know, not interrupting. I guess I also wanted to touch on our kindergarten life, just the day-to-day, because our listeners haven't heard anything about that yet. I guess it's really Monday to Thursday we have the same schedule.
Yeah, because Friday is more of a free day.
Friday is more of a free day. So Monday to Thursday, we start with circle time.
Yeah, we have a circle time with all the kids and the teachers. And then
before that, they have the free play.
Yeah, they have free play.
Oh, that's true. They free play. Before that, they have breakfast.
They have breakfast. Before that, they have breakfast. So basically, they come in, they have free play, they have breakfast.
Yeah.
After breakfast, we have a circle, 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Depends, 20, 25 minutes maybe, something like that.
Yeah.
And then we split. We have two groups. Groups.
Yeah, Maria has one group, and
and then Jane,
I have one group. Yeah,
Jane has the other group. You have the older group.
I have the older group. Yes.
And you have how many in your group?
I have six, and
six,
you have.
And I have seven. I have seven, but I do include one little one as like an eighth.
Because he's less than three. He's under the age of three.
Yeah, and we don't normally accept kids under three. But
right.
He came as
He came with his sister.
But he's very sweet.
He is very sweet.
Shannara actually helps me with him during activity time.
Okay.
Because he needs one.
He takes one.
Yeah. he takes, so literally, I have like someone helping Just for one. So because he's super young and obviously he's just not able to do certain things the group that I have, because they're more like close to four, and some of them are four actually.
Some of them are four,
four years. So we have activities. It depends how long. Well, mine takes about half an hour max.
Okay.
And then they have a little bit of free play before they go outside. And then we're outside for about an hour.
Yeah, and we take like, what, 15 minutes, 10 minutes to get dressed?
Yeah, 10, 15 minutes to get dressed.
Because it's still cold here, and they wear their
layers.
Like a snowsuit type things.
Yeah, and if lots it's of raining, layers. Then oh they have goodness. To put the rubber.
I hate rainy days.
Summer is the best time in kindergarten because you just open the door and they run straight out.
So great. Yeah, they literally just put on their slip on, you know, like sandals or whatever.
Yeah,
and flip flops, and they're like, just go out. But also, I think it takes us time because we also really help the kids to really get dressed properly.
Exactly.
And they do themselves.
Exactly.
Like,
that's what I noticed.
Doing everything for them.
We really encourage them that, okay, you need to practice doing this now.
Yeah.
So, because I know other kindergartens, they go out. It doesn't matter how they're looking.
Yeah.
just go out.
Half zipped and...
Yeah, and they don't practice. And also, to be fair, our kindergarten, like the amount of kids we have, we don't have a lot.
That's true.
So I feel like we also have a little bit of more patience, maybe.
Yeah.
Some days not, but you know, most of the time,
I mean, it's three teachers to 13 children, so that's a pretty pretty awesome ratio.
I think so. Yeah. And we have really great kids and parents.
Yeah, and great teachers.
Yeah. Aww, well, you know.
I do say so myself.
She's like, let me just include this.
We're not humble people. And then they have recess outside for like about an hour, right?
For an hour, and then they come in for lunch
and
half an hour lunch.
Yep. And then they go nap for about an hour.
Time. Yeah, for an hour.
And then free play again.
They have quiet free play where they like maybe more like
it's like puzzles,
Play-Doh, drawing,
magnets. More calm activities.
Yeah, more calm activity.
Yeah.
And then we don't actually have any activities, like actual lesson plan activities in the afternoon. Because some kindergartens do.
Oh.
We used to have that where I used to work before.
Yeah.
At our place
we have activities in the morning.
Yeah.
And we do it by theme. So, this week is still space.
Yeah, we have space.
So, we do, crafts and...
Yeah.
After nap, free play, and then we have snack time.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And then more free play.
And then more
someone's going to be listening who probably works abroad or I don't know, and they're like...
You're getting paid for this?
What is this? I mean, my friend who works in Hong Kong who does what I do, but hers is intense. If she could hear me now, and she'll probably listen to this, she'll be like, oh, you get paid to do nothing, but it's honestly, it's still work because you help them with every little thing.
Exactly. And I think because you're trying to get them to learn it, to do it themselves, which sometimes I feel like is even harder because it takes a lot of mental patience to wait for them.
It's easier to just
zip up the jacket yourself, you know, us to do that. And then on your way off you go. But here we're being patient with them and
you have to do it yourself. You have to try to do it. It doesn't matter how long it takes.
Yeah. But, put the pants over the boots.
But I think it's really good. I mean,
I think these are
the things that are still important. It's part of day-to-day.
Yeah, it's life.
You know?
Yeah.
And it helps them be patient with themselves. It's not just about, you know, reading and writing.
Right. It's really things that they can apply right away because they need to do it in their daily life. You know what I mean? It's not like reading where, you have to pick up a book or, you know, these are things that just naturally has to happen.
And you use it with other things in life. So getting dressed, to be more patient. You might use that when you're having a conflict with your friend, to be more patient, to listen.
Right,
things like
it
that.
Just builds more character.
So, I really enjoy. I think, I mean, it's a big difference, isn't it, from other countries? I'm sure, like, in Australia,
they get a big chance here to develop their social skills.
Yeah. Okay, you guys, I feel like we could go on forever and ever, because it's, there's just so much to cover.
Have you been talking for an hour?
Actually, yes. Just crossed over. But thank you so much for coming on the podcast, and this was, I feel like, one of our most informative episodes, because we have two of you guys. I hope our listeners enjoyed it. Yes, thank you for coming on, and thank you to our listeners, and we'll hear you next week. Bye.